Have a good show.
You! Get your hand out of your pants.
Please put your tray table up. Put the crack pipe down.
You're the least without sin person I know.
Errol, we are on the air right now.
No, I was digging for gold.
That's what's eating Gilbert Grape, my friends.
Well, listen, call me casual, but I love to take my time.
I don't know where your head ends and this weird turtleneck sweater begins.
Speaking of which, whatever happened to that porn star you were dating?
Oh my God, it's huge.
And now,
it's West
by Midwest.
Today is Monday, July 29th, 2013. This is episode 27 of West by Midwest. My name is Chuck Angiori, broadcasting live from Los Angeles, California.
My name is Errol Gribble. I'm broadcasting live from Lansing, Michigan.
And we have our producer, Rob Hubbard, who's recording live from his studio in
Milwaukee, Wisconsin. His studio. Or the spare bedroom.
The second baby's room.
Right. The place that this baby mama lets him hang out.
Exactly. Until the second baby comes along and Rob's just forced to be in the dungeon for the rest of his life.
Yeah, what are you going to do?
Basement, dude. You're getting kicked out.
We're going to see like your train set while we do the podcast.
This is my office. It's not going to be any baby's room.
You say that now. You got a second baby on the way, man.
Wait till that baby comes. My foot is down now.
The baby comes screaming.
My room.
We'll see how long that lasts.
Exactly. Friends, thank you for joining. What? Who?
I was just going to say we probably won't be in this house when the new one's born.
Oh, that's true.
They're going to be out on the street. Just kidding.
We'll figure it out.
Starting a Kickstarter to keep Rob in a house
for
the winter.
One with an office.
With an office for him. Friends, thank you for joining us this week for West by Midwest. You are watching us live on Google Plus Hangouts. If you go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/WestXMidwest, every Monday you'll grab the link to the Google Plus Hangout where you can watch us, join in, make comments, and join us for the show. Also, please subscribe, stream, and download the show on iTunes later on when we post it. Thanks for joining us this week.
Yeah.
How are you guys doing?
Good. For those of you who are joining us on Google Hangouts, you'll notice that it's a little more light outside because we decided to get our shit together and actually record a decent hour instead of like fucking 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, so we'll probably have early record times for our shows on Mondays and usually new episodes on Tuesdays every week. So that's something you can look forward to every week.
Yeah.
Two days back-to-back with the boys from West by Midwest. You know that's how you want to start your week.
Until we screw up and the episodes come out 4 days late.
Oh, Ed Graybo knows what we're talking about.
What's up, Ed Graybo? So it's pretty exciting. I just have to share this because Facebook has changed their insights. Mm-hmm. So you can get like a more detailed view of like your fans and your page and stuff.
Yeah.
We are an international podcast.
International? What are you talking about, Errol Gribble?
We got fucking fans from 5 different countries.
5 countries? Which ones?
Yep. Well, we got 177 people from the United States of America.
Thank you.
Three Canucks. 2 friends from the Philippines.
What?
I'm guessing that's got to be your family.
Family.
And someone from France and someone from the UK.
Oh, bonjour.
Bonjour.
Hello, Gabna.
Thank you for joining our show. Wow. International hit.
Hit. We're huge. We're like Hasselhoff in Germany right now.
Or Bestiality in Germany.
Heyo. Yeah, it's fun. And we actually have, guess which city we have the most number of fans in?
Detroit.
No.
What?
No. We only got 5 from D-Town.
Okay, so
Denver, Colorado, with 14 people.
Wow, the stoners love us.
The stoners fucking love us, dude. Rob Hubbard bringing your fans from Colorado in.
Podcasts are huge in the middle of the country.
Are they?
I don't know.
They're hiking. They're skiing.
You got nothing else to do.
Yeah, they need something on their iPod while they're skiing and hiking.
That's right, while they're
snowboarding. Out. Yeah, snowboarding down.
We also have more women than men.
You see?
The ladies love us. Lady kill us.
A couple of Tomcats here on the show.
Oh, it's good stuff. And our biggest demographic, you saw that movie. Our biggest demographic is the 25 to 34 bracket.
Nice.
That is the much sought after 25 to 34.
That's my most sought after age. I'm like, I want to stay in that bracket and not continue to age.
You're already out of that bracket.
I know. That's what sucks about it.
Anyway, so you had a good week?
Yeah, nice week. I tried a new fast food item today. I had today Popeyes released the chicken waffle tenders with honey maple dipping sauce. It was really good.
So is it like, what are they, wrap it in a waffle? Where does the waffle come in?
What happens is that it's just very, very tender and moist chicken tenders with a very, very light breading. It doesn't have any kind of waffle aspect to it, honestly. But they give you this like sweet maple syrup or something with it, or sauce, and that kind of makes it into like a chicken and waffle situation, like in your head. But it's still very good. The chicken is super tasty. So
this is how I can tell you work in food service. You're like, there's a light breaded coating of it's a scrumptious tender chicken McNugget.
Very moist.
With a moist and sweet and tangy honey mustard waffle sauce. You get
take
paid.
A look at our desserts tonight.
You get paid to get people to eat more food. But you also had something else, which is new this week, from Carl's Jr., which we don't have Carl's Jr. out here, which makes me fucking angry. There's no Carl's
Hardee's?
Jr. We got Hardee's. We have
Hardee's and Carl's Jr. are the same restaurant.
That's right.
They are?
Yes.
I can go to a Hardee's and get one of these ice cream sandwiches.
I don't think so.
You cannot.
We're kind of the same restaurant.
No, Rob, you're just an don't
share
asshole.
Well, they just don't share. I mean, it's the same company, but they I don't know if they share the same.
Yeah, I think Carl's Jr.'s burgers are a little bit more elaborate.
Red Lobster and fucking something else are the same company, too.
The OG, Olive Garden.
Olive Garden is the same company, too. You don't get the same shit at those restaurants.
Nope. That's how it works. So, on my way home from Popeyes, while I was eating my chicken and waffle tenders in the car, when I got over to Carl's Jr., I picked up the new Pop-Tart ice cream sandwich.
Sounds delicious.
Yeah, it was a strawberry. Strawberry Pop-Tart.
Strawberry
Pop-Tart. Rob's favorite word is strawberry, I guess.
That is my favorite word right now.
What's going on with strawberry? Where did this come from?
I guess I would have to say that I started saying it like that in Denver, hanging out with Ginny Palmieri.
Nobody knows who that is.
Yeah, anyways, for some
way
reason...
Way to name drop on our podcast.
For some reason, we were wasted, and we just kept saying strawberry, like the British do. Strawberry.
Yeah, so
strawberry,
Rob...
and for some reason, it just...
Rob hasn't lived in Denver in, like, 2 years.
I don't know why this is a thing with you now. For those of you... Rob... actually visited Michigan this week. It was his grandma's birthday, and so I got to see him. He came and saw my show. We were at dinner, and he was like, it's my new word, strawberry. Like, one, it's not a new word.
Strawberry's not a new word.
Not how you say it. It's not
my new favorite word, not a new word.
Strawberry.
But yeah, I got a new word for you. It's and.
Oh my God! How about you let the bakers do the bacon, okay, pal? But it was good to see you, regardless of how ridiculous your vocabulary is. I enjoyed hanging out with you this weekend.
As did I. Thank you.
So Rob came and saw my show, Tuna Does Vegas, at the Williamston Theater. And what'd you think, my friend?
Oh, it was funny. It was very good. It was very good.
Fine family fun.
Laughed at times uncontrollably.
I did. I saw that. His grandmother made sure. Now the Williamson Theater is a small professional theater. It only seats like 108 people. It's and it's like a thrust stage, so it's really intimate, which is one of the reasons I love working there. But Rob's grandma made sure that he and Katie, his girlfriend, were right up front.
Front row.
Right where I got to be real intimate with him during the show.
Katie got some pole dancing right in her face.
Yeah, that's true. That's pole danced.
Yeah, that was a great moment.
Now, what was your favorite moment?
My favorite moment by far.
If you say the fucking Asian person, I'm gonna kill you.
Let me tell you something. That will.
We'll discuss that in a second. What was your favorite character? What was your favorite moment?
Okay, there you have. You play that one character that is the gun salesman or the used gun salesman.
Girl? She's a woman.
Yes, yeah, her name. Sales girl.
Yeah, Dee Dee Snavely. She's Dee Dee's used weapons. Yes.
And then Daba plays the owner of the hotel.
No, he's a hotel security guard. You clearly were you high when you showed him?
He was a security guard. No.
Not that there's much of a plot to this play, but.
But what did they call him? He's the one that got shot by Sinatra?
Yeah, his name's Shot. He got the name because he was shot in the butt by Frank Sinatra when he was a baby. he works at he's the hotel security guard at the Hula Chateau Resort in South Las Vegas.
Okay, so Dee Dee holds him up and she's patting him. And then as she's patting around his knees, he does a little, And then Dee Dee's like, oh. And Daba gives the oh yeah look.
I like how Chuck's face is like, I guess he had to fucking be there to be.
Chuck's texting somebody.
I'm
right
actually
now.
On the phone. That is true.
So yeah, it's basically just one big dick joke.
Yes.
There's this woman and she's trying to be a security, she's trying to be a bodyguard for her friend who won a jackpot. And Shot comes in, and so she pats him down to make sure he doesn't have a weapon, and she feels up his giant penis.
Oh,
geez. That was Rob's favorite part of the play. But also, as our listeners know, I play a super racist character named Wohu, a Chinese acupuncturist.
Wohu.
Rob, Chuck hates it because it's super racist. Rob Hubbard, what do you think?
Wohu is as spot on as a real Asian American is.
Oh my God. Asian American?
Well, she's more of just a straight out Asian.
Okay, then why'd you say that?
Wait, why is she
then spot it's totally on? Not. Yeah.
No, Wohu's. Hey, first of all, Wohu is an Asian American.
What is she? Chinese?
I don't.
Filipino?
Yes. She's, I don't know, I didn't do my background on her, but she does live in America. She's an American citizen.
So it's a spot on white man's racist.
Yes. It's, here, let me show you. So
yes.
for the audience on Google
Asian,
Plus.
Who lives in America, not technically Asian American if you're trying to be all like Fabi about it.
What's the difference?
Well, if I understand correctly, Errol's doing it from like a fresh off the boat thing, but it lives
no,
in.
She works there. She's
well, right,
got
right,
green
no.
Card.
No, sure, well, but she's not. She wasn't born in America. She doesn't speak English very clearly. He's making a funny.
No, that's
like
true.
Stereotypical Asian sounding impression of you know like a Asian person.
And her husband's from Switzerland, so she's a multi-international. Anyway, so this is what Rob thinks is a spot-on impression. I do this. I come walking in, and I'm like, oh, hello! Tazo acupuncture! Like, the teeth.
Wow!
The teeth, the eyes, everything. All you need is, like, tape on either side of my eyes to pull them out. Offensive thing I've ever
done. It is pretty offensive.
Second. You were like, yeah, it was the most fun.
There was a really old Asian guy right in front. He was
who was loving it.
Yeah. That's because we're very agreeable people, okay? We just smile when things are uncomfortable and laugh when we don't understand what you're saying and just nod yes.
He was nodding the whole damn show.
He was nodding off the whole damn show.
Oh, no, he wasn't.
He was.
He was? This Asian guy was falling asleep?
Well, he was an old guy. He was an old fellow.
My dad straight up fell asleep at your show.
Your
I'm sorry,
dad fell asleep
I'm sorry, Errol Virgilio.
Oh well.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sad that I'm not going to be able to make your show. But I'm glad that Rob
did it. For our listeners, it does run through August 18th, so you can come check it out. You can throw angry things at me. Although Rob will tell you, well, who got one of the biggest laughs on the show?
Well, it's because partly because your wig was starting to fall off.
That's the joke.
Oh, that is the joke?
I mean, it's one of those found jokes, because we were like, wow, this thing's huge. And it's like, yep. So, and it doesn't fall off. It just falls down in front of my eyes.
Yeah, just a little bit. I mean, it never really falls off. So you're trying to do that.
Dang. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, there's lots of stuff in it that people think... There's lots of things that the people think happen, and it's like, oh my god, that was a total accident, and it's not. We planned all those.
What a disappointment. The magic has been ruined.
Yeah. Speaking of magic,
you tricked me.
Let's get to the news. A Subway employee puts his penis on sandwich bread, and another one freezes his urine at work.
This is so crazy, because I just I go to get Popeyes and Carl's Jr. today, and these people are probably stuck of this Pop-Tart in his ass and then fucking served it to me.
Seriously, those chicken waffle nuggets or whatever had scrotum all over them.
Right, so that sauce wasn't fucking honey barbecue sauce, all right?
Gross.
Some sort of white liquid.
Anyway, so a Subway sandwich artist admitted today to putting his penis on the store's sandwich bread and posting the photo to Instagram.
Nice. Where? I'm going to like it.
Well, his name's at Ian Jett, so you can check that out. One of the men, Cameron Boggs, admitted on Instagram that, quote, "Today at work I froze my pee in a water bottle." Boggs posted and then later deleted the most incriminating photo, which depicts a man rubbing his genitalia on foot-long bread. It was posted on Instagram by username Weed Priest, one word, with a caption that reads, "My name is at Ian Jett, and I will be your sandwich artist today."
Oh. Weed Priest making my sandwich. Oh, God.
I mean, you know, like, art is subjective, so I mean, I guess that's one hell of a sandwich artist.
I'm guessing this fool was putting his penis on a 6-inch, all right?
He just said it was a foot long.
He lied to all the ladies, said it was a foot long.
Oh. So a representative from Subway Public Relations released a statement. The isolated incident is not representative of Subway sandwich artists. These actions are not tolerated, and the franchisee took immediate action to terminate the two employees involved.
I love how this the title of sandwich artists is trademarked.
It's trademarked.
Like, hey, I am a sandwich artist, okay?
Like, I can't be a sandwich artist unless I work for Subway. I consider myself an independent sandwich artist. I put my penis on my sandwiches. I can post that shit to Instagram.
Listen, man, you're a scab. You're going against the union of sandwich artists. No, it's funny though, because if you do, you know, like, and Errol, you guys know, it's like when you go on like a set for like background and stuff. You know, those people are like, you know, they're really just extras or whatever, but they call themselves atmosphere artists or like background art, you know
yeah,
what I mean? Like
yeah,
it's kind of like funny, like that kind of distinguished.
Yeah, like, hey, did you check out? That's been happening a lot in Michigan because, you know, there were the film incentives and they're still sort of around. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of my friends and stuff are doing background work and they'll be like, oh, yeah, my new movie just came out. Like, what movie? And they're like, oh, yeah, man, it's like a fucking blockbuster with Hugh Jackman. I'm like, that's your movie? Like, yeah, dude, I was one of the guys in the crowd. It's not your movie.
I worked with George Clooney and Ryan Gosling and Ann Arbor.
That's the other one. That's the other great one. Happens all the time. Yeah, man, I worked with George Clooney on this movie. Did you? Just because you could see him from 20 feet away doesn't mean you worked with him.
From 100 feet away, you were in a stadium, and he was all the way on the field.
You and Clooney ain't BFF, all right?
That's funny. Well... I guess we're just not safe at any fast food establishment because people are just going to...
Yeah, I don't want to go to Subway ever again.
Spit on our food, stick their wieners on our food. It's just
I got
it's
a
not
dick
even...
sandwich and peas juice for fucking lunch yesterday. I can't wait to tell this kid who works at he's one of the dressers on the show, mm-hmm. and he always, like, clockwork. He's like a fucking Jared wannabe. He comes in with, like, a 6-inch of Subway
That's
every day.
Right there.
He'd be like, yo, check it for penis.
He's got a 6-inch of pubic hairs with on Italian herbs and cheese.
Oh, that ain't herbs.
A guy turned himself in for child porn because malware on his computer told him to.
I love this. I can't believe this.
Basically, what happened was this guy was surfing porn, and you know, like a pop-up came up saying that, you know, one of these fake pop-ups that said that his computer had child pornography on it, and he would have to pay $300 to a fake FBI website to get the pop-up to go away. And it's just a JavaScript hack that people use, and it's called ransomware. I don't know, you know. That's just kind of what happened to this guy. He thought it was for real, and he didn't, you know, he didn't want to make sure that he was ponying up for no reason, so he decided to go to the police and inquire about any potential outstanding warrants with his computer in tow. He did not have any warrants, but the police was kind of, you know, skeptical about the whole situation. So they
were like, hey, mind if we take a look at that computer you got?
Exactly. They took the computer from him and found child pornography on it, ended up getting arrested from a fake pop-up ransomware site.
That's awesome.
Really, really sad. There was a couple of conversations with a child and like maybe 2 or 3 pictures. So he was
arrested
3 counts for child pornography.
Oh my God! Oh. See, this is why the NSA does not need to be spying on everybody. Idiots are gonna fucking police themselves. Right?
Exactly.
Like, if you're doing something wrong, guess what? You're gonna fucking catch yourself.
I just, you know, it's funny. It's great. I liked the story this week because, man, I was just such a To Catch a Predator fan. Remember, Errol, when we first moved to LA? To Catch a Predator marathons on MSNBC, and we were just so into that. And I just love this whole thing. It just sucks that. It's gone, man. I miss it.
Why did they do away with it? It was like entrapment or whatever?
Yeah, no. Because some fool like committed suicide, like shot himself or something. Everything came down on him and it just blew up in his face and he just like.
Well, quit looking at fucking kitty porn. Quit trying to contact some 13-year-old girl, dude. Jesus.
Right.
Yeah, remember we were gonna do that like. To Catch a Predator sketch.
We're gonna do a sketch, dude. It was gonna be great. Yeah, it was gonna be great. And then that year, honestly, like 2007, some guy killed himself in the middle of one of those tapings. So.
Well, here's a guy who probably wants to kill himself. A Maine man gets a week in jail for pooping his pants.
Shit, Errol, you would have been in jail like a couple times.
Seriously, I have shit my pants in public many times. Many a time. The first U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals last week upheld a conviction against a Maine man who served a 7-day jail sentence for willfully damaging and creating a hazard and nuisance in the federal courthouse in Portland.
He pooped his pants. That's the hazard and nuisance?
Yes. Well, but the hazard is that he left the mess in the bathroom after attempting to clean himself out. The maintenance worker who had to deal with it said that 75% of the floor was covered in feces, while more was smeared more than 2 feet up on the walls and on the paper towel and toilet paper dispensers, on the toilet paper itself, and on part of the toilet seat, and the left side of the toilet bowl.
Okay, so he did this for spite, right? Like he was being malicious when he did this?
That's the argument, right? The maintenance worker and a lot of people are saying like, oh, there was like this Social Security case that he lost twice in that courthouse, so he was pissed off at the place. But he was like, no, I was embarrassed. Anyway, let me get to it. So the outrageously graphic 57-page court document written by distinguished judges who sit one level below the U.S. Supreme Court. Keep that in mind. Include vivid comparisons to spaghetti with meat sauce and chunky peanut butter.
I'm just going to not eat for the rest of the day. Okay,
yeah,
we got Subway,
folks,
pubic hairs on it.
This is why we should not do the podcast during the dinner hour.
My supper is ruined.
Ronald Strong was the guy's name. He said he was 50 at the time. He had a heart condition that required medication that may have affected his bowel control. He arrived at the courthouse on business for an unrelated civil case. He was being screened by the security. He informed the guard that he had used the bathroom and that he was defecating in his pants. Could you imagine, like, all right, take out your keys and your wallet and make sure. And they're like, he's like, excuse me, sir, I'm shitting my pants.
I gotta get to the bathroom now, man, or you're gonna have shit on your shoe.
And so what happens? The guard escorts him to the restroom, quote, with strong, intermittently trailing feces onto the floor.
Wow, this guy.
Which he later describes as liquid, and there was pieces in it. Dripped down his leg all the way to my ankles.
This is disgusting.
It gets worse. Okay. But in his defense, Strong claimed that the cleaning lady had exaggerated the extent of the damage, and that he was so humiliated and intent on cleaning himself that he wasn't paying any mind to the condition of the bathroom. He unequivocally denied deliberately putting excrement on federal property.
Yeah. Didn't they say that it was 2 feet up the walls?
That's what. And he's like, that's an exaggeration. It was not 2 feet. But it's like, how do you... It said he was, like, taking off his socks and stuff. He was just using everything. He was like, you know when you spill, like, milk or spaghetti sauce and how hard it is to just clean it up and you just find anything you can to, like, sop it up?
Sure.
Sure.
Why did you have to say spaghetti sauce?
So that's what, but spaghetti sauce is what it says, like.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, that guy described it as spaghetti sauce.
Right, right. Like, why'd you have to use that, man?
Oh, man.
But, so obviously, you and I and many people assume, like, you can't make that much mess without being on purpose.
Yeah.
Like, I've had. As you know, like, when I was doing the Love Carbon Loving It, I have fucking exploded. I've ruined clothes. And I had to clean myself up in a public bathroom. And, like, yeah, it was gross. But the bathroom didn't look gross.
Yeah,
like,
it wasn't 75% of under your feet wasn't covered in your own feces.
Yeah, there wasn't, like, spaghetti meat and chunky peanut butter shit all over the floor.
You weren't dripping from your ankles all the way to the bathroom.
Well, I might have been a little. Anyway, but the judge is actually contrary to most people's reviews. Contrary to the majority's views, the fact that 75% of the floor was covered with feces does not support an inference of willfulness, said Judge Juan R. Toruella, noting that there wasn't any feces on the drywall, on the sink, or the mirror, places one would reasonably expect the person intent on vandalism to put it to make cleanup more difficult.
That's what is wrong with this judge, man? It was on the toilet paper dispenser.
Yeah, but he's...
He was straight up rubbing his ass on that.
It was not. You can have it on your hand and then grab. But he was like, because you didn't put, like, a shit smile on the mirror, it's not vandalism. Torella delves into the context of the cleaning lady's use of the term smear in her testimony, noting that while the majority interpreted the word to mean it was intentional, she actually described it as, quote, not necessarily like finger smears, but just chunks. Chunks and smears, pretty much, kind of like chunky peanut butter.
Jesus, everyone thought that it looked like chunky peanut butter.
No rational fact finder could infer willfulness from the consistency of feces, the dissenting judge concludes. There's no word yet on whether Strong will continue his appeal in front of the Supreme Court.
Oh yeah, this should go to the Supreme Court for sure.
This is a historic case.
It's a case for Clarence Darrow to come back from the dead.
It's going to change our country. You can feel free to spread your feces. Although, I mean, I would feel like, yeah, there's that much shit on the floor. You had to do it on purpose, right?
Mm-hmm. And maybe, and who knows? Maybe he ate like 10 jars of chunky peanut butter just to, like, throw these people off.
Maybe he's just got a solid diet of spaghetti and meat sauce and fucking chunky peanut butter and just...
You think I can hold that in?
Like a... Oh. Fire, I mean, babies do that, though, right? Like, Rob, do you ever have, like, a... Does Wesley ever have, like, an explosion in the bathroom where you're like, oh, my God, it's like...
He doesn't use the bathroom.
No, but, like, don't you change him in the bathroom?
No, we change him on changing tables, either up in his room or in a little...
You can clearly tell how much I know about parenting.
I mean, he'll... He'll eventually have a couple of blowouts where it'll creep all the way up his back and shit. But he's been pretty good so far. We've only had one of those.
Keep him away from the chunky peanut butter and the spaghetti meat sauce, and he'll be fine.
Will do. Thank you for the advice.
Speaking of, like, horrible lies or trying to get away with lies, mm-hmm. a man told the police that he was with a prostitute because she was selling him tomatoes.
That's, like, the worst excuse you could have.
Like, what are
the you... The cops are like, selling tomatoes, is that a new...
Is that what it's... How many tomatoes is this going to cost me? 300 tomatoes to go all the way?
Oh, man. What happened with this guy?
Well, it's a 39-year-old from Dudley, and I'm guessing Dudley is in England. This happened across the pond. I didn't do my research, whatever. He was followed by police after they spotted the sex worker waiting for him in his Nissan Micra.
Yeah, we don't sell that car here. That's got to be...
No, that's out there. Yeah, because I also don't know, like, the... this was all in pounds. Anyway, he was then stopped and arrested on suspicion of soliciting. The married security guard...
Way to go.
...denied the allegations in his interview, claiming that he was withdrawing 20 pounds from the cash point so he could buy tomatoes.
I still think that selling tomatoes is some sort of sex act that this guy was having, and he really was going to be like...
Look, I'm trying to buy some tomatoes. You know what I'm saying? Me and the girl, we're going to go get it home. We're going to go eat tomatoes. They're like, no. They saw through it, and they ended up finding him and giving him a bunch of jail time or whatever. It's good times. I'm going to go. Speaking of which, I do have a tomato growing in my garden.
You do?
I do. I picked it today. I got my tomatoes are coming up, my peppers, my beans, my green beans.
Better hurry up. Summer's almost over, man.
If any ladies want to come on over and buy my tomatoes.
Errol is selling tomatoes all weekend long. Where's your garden set up? On the outside of the kitchen?
Like, yeah, like right outside the front door. We have this tiny little patch out in our apartment building, like...
Are you allowed to grow there? It's like it's for you guys
to grow? What are they going to do? Fucking fire me? what are they going to do? Arrest my ass for selling tomatoes? I'm not buying tomatoes from a prostitute.
Are they fresh organic tomatoes and peppers?
They are.
Really?
No, there's this, it's your little patch. Now technically you should share it with like the whole building. And I did have a neighbor lady who was like, oh, wow, you're growing a bunch of stuff. And I was like, yeah, there's – and she was like, oh, I'm thinking of, you know, putting my sunflowers out there. I was like, that sounds great. I'll leave a spot open for you.
Like, she didn't keep do your shit. Keep your fucking sunflowers away from my food. You're going to
– Keep your shit out of my garden.
It's going to block all the sun.
Seriously.
For my tomatoes.
I need some fucking ripe tomatoes.
And my strawberries.
I got a strawberry patch going on in the backyard.
Strawberries?
I'm going to send you some like seeds from the dispensary, some clones, and then I want you to drop a couple of them in there and just like see what happens. See what your neighbors think when a weed plant sprouts up.
That would be awesome. That would make most of my neighbors actually really excited. So another fun robber story this week, bumbling
burglar. Idiot criminals this bumbling week on criminals. West by Midwest.
An armed robber pauses to feed a crying baby.
Oh, the thoughtful robber.
Yeah, that's right. Kojak Mista and four accomplices broke into a house in Tangerang, 20 miles from the Indonesian capital of Jakarta. Mista and his gang held all the adults present in the house captive. And Indonesian reporters were told that Mista and his accomplice got into the property by scaling a wall. The baby's mother, Fance Lua, said that she screamed when she awoke to see the robbers pointing a gun at her, causing the baby to wake up crying. And so this guy was like, I asked his mother how to make him stop crying. She said he had to be fed with milk. So she like helps him. She talks him through like how to make the formula and stuff. Mista, who could face up to 10 years in jail if charged and found guilty of robbery, said, I gave the formula to the baby while cradling him. Not long after, the baby fell asleep, so I put him to bed. I have a kid, so I know how to cradle a baby.
So why did he have to ask how to calm the baby down? First of all, I love that this guy's name is Mister, and then the lady's name is what's up, Fance?
Come on. They're Indonesian.
They're Indonesian. Yeah, no, they've got different names, but yeah, that dude's name's Mister, man.
Kojak Mister.
Mister. That scene is like straight out of a movie, you know, like one of those like comedies where they're like robbing somebody. Yeah, it's like totally just happened in real life.
Yeah.
Like they're all screaming at each other, but they're pointing guns at the mom. And they're like, "How do I put this kid to sleep?
Give him this formula. Give him a formula. What do I do? What do I do? Grab the bottle off the damn shelf.
Keep your goddamn hands up.
It's in the bottom drawer. Bottom drawer.
Where are your jewels?"
Then they have this heartwarming moment at the end of them. Like, "We'll see you later. Your baby's beautiful. Let me hold him back to you."
Hands the baby over. And
hands
the
baby
the
back. Yeah, that's when the cops show up. They're like, "Way to waste the time with the baby."
Thanks for waking the baby up.
Yeah, good times. Hey, we should say that Eric Hubbard, who was on the show, two episodes ago?
Two episodes.
He, a professional ultimate disc player for the Detroit Mechanics, has had an injury, ladies and gentlemen, and he might be out of the season.
Well, you know, it's only club league right now, so it's not he'll be okay by.
Yeah, he's just playing club league right now, but I don't know. Rob, what's the story?
What's the recovery time on a dislocated shoulder?
He dislocated his shoulder playing his last match, or last play of a club match.
It could be anything at this point. They need to do a follow up. Let's see what the doctor says, but you know, there's pitchers.
Chuck, Chuck, did you say WebMD?
Yes.
Just fucking go online.
Yeah, pitchers, baseball pitchers come back from dislocated shoulders and do fine. NFL quarterbacks, Matt Stafford of the Detroit Lions actually finished a game with a dislocated shoulder.
Man, but, yeah, this is ultimate frisbee. This motherfucker's like, "I'm out.
I'm done. I'm retired."
There was no choice. It was last play of the game.
But
he'll have some recovery. I think typically all this really means is that it's more likely to pop out again in the future. But he'll generally be fine.
He'll probably be able to pull like a Mel Gibson Lethal Weapon thing where he can just like run his shoulder in a wall and pop it back in.
Yeah.
Well, we wish Eric Hubbard a speedy recovery. Godspeed,
yes,
my friend.
Godspeed, Eric. We want to thank all our listeners for tuning in. And for the people, for the one guy who watched us, I think he's gone. Oleg Kushevoy is fucking out. He's fucking Russian, straight up Russian.
Did we get a new country?
We got a new country.
Wow.
Woohoo! It's funny, though, because I'm like, with all this sunshine, my fucking face looks shiny as shit. Need some fucking makeup in here. Speaking of which, I got like a makeup treatment this week. Did I tell you that?
That's right. What happened with that? You mentioned something about a photo shoot.
I did a print job this week.
You're a model now?
I'm a fucking model. It's so ridiculous. The work.
What's it for?
People don't understand. As an actor, you do anything. For one time, I dressed up like the Cowardly Lion and handed out like suckers at a fucking park. That wasn't a job I had. I just did that once.
No, wait a second. That wasn't affiliated with anybody, actually. I just rolled up in my Cowardly Lion costume to a park.
Started soliciting children.
With a couple of lollipops I stole from the local dentist.
No, that was for a run for cancer or something. But, no, this was a print job for the Lake Trust Credit Union. I'm going to be – they're going to take pictures and put them on their website. They have like a bunch of different characters, right? And each character is a different profile that you as a customer of Lake Trust can most identify with. And then they will choose services based on that will fit you.
So which – do you know which customer that you
– Yeah, my profile was the lazy doesn't care about money college kid. who's just interested in convenience and like doesn't want to plan ahead or think about anything too much.
That's hilarious.
The stupid college kid, that was me.
That's which, you.
Part of me was really excited because I was like, all right, fucking 35-year-old
still,
college
yeah,
kid.
Yeah, still rocking the fucking
still
youngness.
Still rocking the baby face.
Nice job, my friend. So do you know when this website's going to be up?
I don't. They have a few more shoot dates with some other folks because they obviously have different demographics and stuff. And right. It's also about, like, tailoring to certain cities. So for Lansing, we did Cravings Popcorn, and so we could give them some business. And we did some MSU stuff, so, like, it's about the campus and whatever. But it's also going to be in Grand Haven and in Ann Arbor. So there's a few more shoot dates and then whatever. We'll see. Keep your eyes peeled, folks, for the fat
That's
kid
awesome.
On the Lake Trust Financial. And it's, what's funny is, like, they like the ladies who did my hair, like, mm-hmm. did this ridiculous part in it.
Yeah.
And as you know, my hairline is starting to get a little in the tooth. And I was like, hey, don't you want to like comb it forward just a little? And they were like, no, it looks great. So
isn't that how the kids are doing it these days?
Right. Like, aren't the kids doing like the Bieber thing? Don't you want to? And yeah, so I don't think I look like I'm 40.
Oh, come on.
Eating some popcorn.
This is 40.
This is 40.
Well, no, that's really cool, Errol. I can't wait to see the website. Speaking of websites, we are on our show is on a streaming
a segue. It's a good
website.
Segue.
Rob, do you want to kind of brief our?
Yeah, you can watch all of a lot of our stuff live, like just you know, or not live, but live streaming, like a Ustream channel. Now we have our own internet channel.
Right, Rob? We're on a comedy channel.
We're on a comedy channel, but it's pretty much all us right now.
Really?
Yeah, I think we have 8 episodes up there, and it's just cycling through them.
Nice.
And,
so
and Blob Squatch is in the mix.
What?
I'm trying to get Buster West. And Yandu up there.
Really?
We got to redo the score.
Might as well.
So tell us about this channel, Rob.
Well, I guess it's like you go to a TV network and they have all these channels you can scroll through and they're just streaming stuff like any TV station would be.
Sure, yeah. We know how internet TV works. I was hoping you would tell people where to find it.
Oh. Well, shit, let's see.
God damn it.
We'll post the link to our Facebook page.
We will do that.
I didn't know I was going to be...
Sorry. Putting Rob on the spot with...
Because it's not an easy website to remember.
But
right,
it's through...
IBVN, I think, IBVN.com. Yeah.
It's through a friend of yours in Denver, yeah?
Yeah, and it's fairly new. They haven't finished the main portal yet, but it's live, and you can go to it. And they're working on an iPhone app. Then that's not open to the public yet, but it will
Do
be.
Do you know what IVBN stands for, or anything? Or
no, but if I didn't know we're gonna do this, I'd pull all that shit up.
Internet video, something network. No, I don't know. I was just guessing.
No, that sounds good. It's probably...
That's not just because it sounds good. Chuck, all this is getting edited out. I'm going to ask, what is it? And
okay.
Rob's going to say it.
Internet Video Broadcast Network.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Denver.ivbn.net.
Internet Video Broadcasting Network.
Featuring West by Midwest.
Yeah.
We are dominating the comedy channel on that. So
dominating.
You can check us out streaming, and hopefully they'll add some more content, but that's another site that we're on. You can check us out at Denver.
Yeah, and that's fun just because, you know, if you don't want to, like, pick something on the YouTube channel, just open that up and just put it on in the background until our voices make you want to kill people.
Until your baby starts crying uncontrollably.
You got to feed it.
And see Errol in Tuna Das Vegas running through August 18th, Lansing, Michigan Williamson Theater. It's a riot of a show. You should go check it out. Right, Errol, you still 5 performances every weekend?
Still 5 performances every weekend. I'm exhausted, which is why I'm glad we're doing this earlier so I can go to bed. because I could sleep for like 3 days until my next one. I sweat like a fucking animal. And check Charles out on his web series, Bad Porn, which its new episode is actually coming out this week. Yeah?
Yeah, this will be episode six, second to the last episode, so things are ramping up a little bit.
And if you check
here.
Out our Facebook page, the first five episodes, Chuck's made a little playlist on YouTube, and you can check it out there. Well, I would highly suggest you do. It's short, it's fucking funny, it's stupid.
Oh, it's literally those five episodes in a row is like 15 minutes.
Yeah,
honestly. It's really quick.
Ridiculous. Oh, man. I love it.
Yeah, so we have that. Like us on our Facebook page, facebook.com/WestXMidwest. We're on Twitter at, why do I say that? We're on Twitter at West_X_Midwest is our handle. So tweet us your comments, questions. We have an email address at WestXMidwestPodcast@gmail.com. And you can watch this show, our previous shows, on our YouTube channel, which is just WestXMidwest. Just search that out on YouTube. But most importantly, subscribe, stream, download, maybe write a review on iTunes.
Yeah, tell us how much we suck, please. That'd be awesome.
And tell a friend. That'd be cool.
How
as
much
well.
We suck. That would be awesome.
Wow.
So that is it for this week.
It's been a pleasure.
Yes. Next week it's going to get crazy. We've got lots of fun things happening. I think we're going to introduce our political insider next week, maybe. I don't know.
We'll see. We got a lot of big things coming up on the show. So
a lot of big things.
Stay tuned for us. But thank you so much for listening this week and all those weeks previous. Editing that out.
All right, everybody. So thanks again for listening. I don't even know how to sign off.
I don't know. Okay, all right. Go ahead, Errol. Do it again.
No, go ahead.
Thank you so much for listening this week, friends, and we'll hopefully see you next week. I'm Chuck Anchori.
I'm Errol Gribble. On behalf of Robert Hubbard, this is Van.
West
by Midwest. We'll see you next week.
Blueberry lollipop, little girl, if you be my strawberry bubblegum, it'll be your blueberry lollipop, and then I'll love you till I make it pop.